Hello friends, welcome to another episode of Engineering Today. And believe it or not, we're back with 5 updates today. So let's get into the first one straight away. SpaceX completed building a flightworthy Starship on the 22nd of October. SpaceX finally joined the first flightworthy nosecone assembled with flaps on top of Starship prototype. This nosecone was made of 5 structural stainless steel rings welded with long steel beams. These steel beams are commonly known as stringers. The nose cone was attached to the Starship before conducting the high-altitude flight test. Elon Musk, founder of SpaceX, had tweeted on the 12th of September 2020, SN8 Starship with flaps and nose cone should be done in about a week. Then static fire checkouts, static fire, fly to 60,000 feet and back. SpaceX personnel attached that nose cone of serial number 8 Starship at the company's South Texas site near the Gulf Coast village of Boca Chica. SpaceX team installed the completed nose cone, part of the self-propelled mobile transporter, and then it was brought to the launch test site nearly a couple miles away from the Boca Chica facility. NASA SpaceFlight member Mary tweeted on 23rd of October with a photo of fully prepared Starship, "A beautiful sky behind a fully stacked Starship. SN8, you are beautiful." Only a day before SpaceX Starship SN8 successfully completed the first 3 Raptor engine static fire test at a full thrust, thus creating a milestone. SpaceX has successfully finished building the SN8 vehicle to its full height of about 165 feet. Starship vehicle will launch atop a huge rocket named Super Heavy. CEO Elon Musk said before, "Super Heavy will return to Earth for vertical landings, and Starship will make multiple trips to and from the Moon, Mars, or wherever else it has been sent." He also said, "Starship will be powerful enough to launch itself off the Moon and Mars, but it will need Super Heavy's help to get off Earth." SpaceX removed 1 of 3 Starship Raptor engines. The prototype is likely to fly with only 2 Raptor engines. SpaceX also revealed their 4th engine already in Boca Chica. Musk explained before that their plan was to perform static fire test of 3 Raptor engines along with final inspections and checkouts, then perform another static fire test, and finally the high-altitude flight test. SpaceX already completed 2 steps. They'll use second triple Raptor static fire test to check the engine's self-fueling system from the tank located in the nose cone. If static fire test is successful, then SN8 will be on its way to introductory flight of 15 kilometers above and then back to Earth. This static fire would be easily less than a week away. A few days ago, SpaceX posted a job list. It was seeking for a resort development manager, RDM, to Boca Chica, a suitable place to live and work. SpaceX Village has hotels and lodging facilities, tournament events, and kayaking. It will have a special feature of Spaceport Lounge, including bar and restaurant, to host multiple events and parties. It will be the duty of resort development manager to monitor the delightful food services in the Tikibar and all other events of SpaceX Village. SpaceX wrote for that job listing to hire resort development manager, "SpaceX is committed to developing revolutionary space technology, with the ultimate goal of enabling people to live on other planets. Boca Chica Village is our latest launch site dedicated to Starship, our next-generation launch vehicle. SpaceX is committed to developing this town into a 21st-century spaceport." Elon Musk, CEO and founder of SpaceX, named Boca Chica as the gateway to Mars. Mr. Musk shared on the 20th of October, after SN8's Raptor engines passed a critical engine test, "Data from 3 engine Starship static fire this morning looks good. Proceeding with nose cone mate." Elon Musk tweeted 3 photos of the nose cone, Tiki Bar and High Bay, on October 22, 2020. "SpaceX has an aim to improve Boca Chica into a space resort. Musk's company is also establishing resort facilities with outdoor restaurant to serving out warm and delicious food to the employees. It's a bit of refreshment at Tiki Bar." Now let's move into news where Starlink is planning to provide internet at Australia's doorstep. To just after Microsoft announced their partnership with SpaceX to spread cloud computing system through Starlink, another news sparked to the front. SpaceX has been working for several months to make Starlink internet operational in Australia. It had to face a number of obstacles in the path to secure approval for Starlink internet's function in Australia. Starlink would use a constellation of between 4,400 and 40,000 internet beam emitting satellites to create an internet circle around the planet. This Starlink's Australian approval is also one of the major parts of the project. SpaceX has started applying for licenses in four Australian cities to spread Starlink internet, one in Broken Hill, one in Wagon, one in Burua, and another one in Pimba. ABC News Australia confirmed that Australian Communications and Media Authority approved Starlink satellites to become part of the Foreign Space Objects Determination, which lists the number of companies given permission to use Australian aerospace. Starlink got the right in February to use Australian radio frequencies as a foreign-owned satellite. Australian Communications and Media Authority said, SpaceX's inclusion in the determination doesn't confer a right on that entity to obtain a license. Rather, it is a prerequisite before a space apparatus license can be used. And final step of SpaceX is to obtain the spectrum license, which will give Starlink satellites the right to communicate to base stations in Australia. Let's now discuss how the United States SpaceX will make its satellites digitally. The United States Space Force is moving forward with the aim of developing military space hardware. The Air Force Space and Missile System Center, SMC, Commander Lieutenant John Thompson said, "The Space and Missile System Center wants to move down this path, but has a lot to figure out." At a virtual space industry conference organized by the National Defense Industrial Association and the Air Force Association on the 21st of October, he said, "There have been some remarkable digital accomplishments on the aviation side. In space, we need to learn and chart our course. With the collaboration of military infrastructure buyers and contractors in the virtual world, they will design an equipment that will exist in the digital world forever, and it can be used for further development and production. To test digital engineering, three programs have been identified. It would include one modular satellite bus and two next-generation communication satellites. These programs have been taken for a massive change in the military process. All the data regarding missions will be stored in cloud computing site with protection. Government will be the sole owner and manager of that data. Despite a few problems, there will be a lot of advantages in these systems," stated Lieutenant General Thompson. Air Force's senior executive, Will Roper, gave his consent to make digital engineering a priority for future programs. Mr. Thompson also said in the conference, "We want you to propose ideas for existing or future programs on how you might be able to get us closer to a digital vision." But Commander Lieutenant General John Thompson warned, "We don't want digital engineering, digital thread, digital workforce, digital twins, any of the lingo to become buzzwords. We want to have a common lexicon on what digital means. We cannot have these conversations turn into buzzword bingo and not be about the substance of what goes into it. SMC will also need help of private sector companies to successfully use this digital engineering." Out of three programs identified before, one is a combat bus modular spacecraft, which can be used for different programs. Second one is the projected anti-jam tactical SATCOM program that has a ground system, a group of satellites, and user terminals. Last, or the third one, is the evolved strategic SATCOM program, which would be used in place of the advanced extremely high-frequency satellites. Last of all, SMC's Commander Lieutenant General John Thompson said, "We know that there will be investments required to develop a digital ecosystem, and we are working with Space Force Headquarters to make that investment a reality." Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.